In this edition of Art Loft, we see how dance pushes boundaries of time and space.
We're about making things for the eyes and the senses and communicating through them.
Songwriters gather at the southernmost point.
I always feel like I'm in way over my head among all these writers here. These are the best writers in the world.
A metaphor on the life of an immigrant.
A esta tierra donde pasaría el resto de mis días.
And meet the man who drew Captain America.
I started doing backgrounds, Captain America. I always wanted to draw comics.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from Locust Projects, this is Art Loft. Motionhouse is an international dance troupe known for its innovative take on contemporary dance. In our first story, artistic director Kevin Finnan shed some light on their unorthodox approach to modern dance. Let's take a look.
The company was formed in the 1980s, and the house scene was happening. There was house dances, and there was a lot of underground art really resurfacing again. It was a fun time. And we wanted a name that would capture our spirit of bringing everything together under one roof and trying to make something new.
Motionhouse.
I suppose one of the key ways that we differ from a lot of dance artists is we always start from a theatrical image. We have imagery that we want to communicate and content and theme. And so we start from our visual world and then we evolve our movement language to go with that for each show. We're a spectacular art. We're about making things for the eyes and the senses and communicating through them. And then it's about welding this visual world that we're drawing on from European theatre and all of the great work that's out there, and then putting that into a very visceral physical context so that we really push the physicality in our works. Scattered is a show whereby I wanted to make a show about water. And what fascinates me is that in our Western environment, it's on tap, literally. I showed to my kids, I was in the bathroom one day, I turned the tap off, I said, look at this, fantastic. And my kids' eyes rolled up in their heads, and I'm like, yeah, it's a tap, Dad. And of course, they don't see the magic of just having water on tap. So therefore, it comes down to that key moment of realizing I am distanced from the reality of what it takes to get fresh water to my house whenever I want it. So I want to make a show where I go, look, I'm gonna stop for a minute and go, this is bloody marvelous. This is fantastic. So I make a show about my experience of trying to look at water again. Sometimes some of the imagery is about the beauty of water, it's its sensuousness. There's bits about the show that's about the chemical bonding process of H2O and all the rest of it. But it really doesn't matter if you get those things. It's about how you engage with the theme. Because at the end of the show, if you're thinking about water, then the show served its purpose. We tread a line where we go, and it has its pitfalls and its dangers, where we consider the engagement with the audience, and we consider the type of imagery we use and the duration and the editing and the speed, and all of that has really been informed from working outdoors. We consider, and sometimes we go, you know what, we're going to help them out here, we're going to do this for the audience, and then in other parts we're going to go, I really want to challenge them here, so I'm going to give them something to give them a bit of confidence in us. We're going to challenge them, and then I'm going to bring them back somewhere so they feel that they know where they are. There's lots of art now about, you know, altering ourselves surgically, or we all think of robots or that sort of thing. Nobody thinks about the person working on the construction site with a machine, digging a trench to within an inch of specification, being able to manipulate over different grounds and move. And the way that that person moves that machine is a thing when you have a skilled operator of intense beauty. So we started making these machine dances with machines that I think that in the US are referred to as backhoes, where we would dance with them and on them. We would create movement language for them. The machines would pick us up and pass us between machines. We engage with it. And the machine dance was really a whole exploration of going, look, what is dancing and what is a body? So it had a serious intellectual underpinning to it. Actually, when we made the show, you get huge audiences and you get loads of kids come along. They don't care about what a body is or whatever. They're just having a great time looking at the spectacle of these machines dancing and moving. But for other people, there is the potential for them to read further into it. And I always really liked the two sides. We got one of the largest commissions of the Cultural Olympiad was to create a show for The Voyage. So in the middle of Birmingham, we created a full-sized ship. We built a passenger liner, you know, four stories high, in between the big colonial buildings and the city hall, right in the middle of the city. It was an enormous spectacle on its own. And then we projected onto the ship and onto the buildings around a whole fundamental story of why do people journey? The Voyage was very interesting because, again, it was like, okay, we're going to create spectacle, but it's got to be engaging. Because spectacle has become a dirty word in theatre because it's the empty spectacle. It's nothing but its appearance. I think today is the era of spectacle, again, the way it speaks to us on a direct level. To make something on that scale, which is emotionally engaging, was one of the great moments in my career. It's kind of interesting because you know that you can't top it. And then you go, oh, well, maybe I should stop. But actually, last year taught me a lot of new things and I want to bring those into the work. And touring here and getting the reaction of audiences here to the show that we are touring, you go, oh, that's so interesting. That works. That was. I want to put that in the next show.
If you'd like to learn more about this unique dance troupe, visit them online at motionhouse.co.uk.
We run about 150 to 160 riders a year, and anywhere from 40 to 50 shows in 5 days, so it's a lot of fun.
This, it's not a bad backstage area. People like to have a good time here.
Our next film comes courtesy of the Borscht Film Festival. Narrated by a dying shark, Reinaldo Arenas is the true story of the last few hours in the life of an unintentional immigrant. This film by Lucas Levia premiered at Borscht 7 in 2011 and went on to play Slam Dance, South by Southwest, and over a dozen other festivals.
Tierra en contra de mi voluntad. Por aquellas aguas hirvientes del Caribe. Arrastrado a playa por una fuerza invisible. A esta tierra donde pasaría el resto de mis días. Solamente quería una vida mejor. Solamente quería sobrevivir. Era parecida a mi tierra, pero diferente. Una caricatura triste. El aire tóxico. Difícil respirar. Luché, pero no entendía contra qué luchaba. Toda mi energía perdida en vano. exhausto, derrotado al fin de mi vida, miré esas criaturas extrañas en esa tierra que no conocía. Solamente entonces entendí que cualquier intento a entender era en vano. Solo entonces entendí la llanura de esta tierra. Y entonces comprendí.
Filmmaker Lucas Levia is one of the founders of the Borscht Film Festival and Borscht Corp. His last two short films premiered at Sundance and have been screened at over 60 other festivals, including South by Southwest, Milan, BAM, and MoMA New York. Last year, he was named to Filmmaker Magazine's 25 New Faces of Independent Film list. You can find out more about the Borscht Film Festival by visiting their website at borschtcorp.com.
We run about 150 to 160 riders a year, and anywhere from 40 to 50 shows in 5 days, so it's a lot of fun.
This, it's not a bad backstage area. People like to have a good time here.
These days, it seems superheroes are everywhere, leaping off the page and into big screen blockbusters and beyond. But nearly three quarters of a century earlier, these comic books were meant to thrill young audiences in a simpler way. Enter Allen Bellman, a young man who loved to doodle, today a mild-mannered South Florida retiree, but we reveal his secret identity as the man who drew Captain America.
My name is Allen Bellman, and I work for Timely Marvel Comics in 1942. I started doing backgrounds, Captain America. I always wanted to draw comics. My father had a bakery. Every chance I had, I'd draw on the paper bag. And I'd open a book and there was a white space in a hardcovered book. I'd draw in there. It's just something you have in you. It was Columbus Day, 1942. And I said to my dad, I says, I'll go tomorrow, it's a holiday. He said, no, you go today. I said, Dad, and we went back and forth, and he won. And I thanked my dear dad because I don't know where I'd be now if I didn't listen to him. Because I got that job in 10, 15 minutes. They said, you start Monday. I went to the High School of Industrial Art, and I went on and off at night at Pratt Institute. But actually, it was on the job that I got my training and the ability to improve, the opportunity to keep improving my work. And I always worked and strived to have a better job. I was never really ever happy, whatever I do, even now. I always feel I could do better, more and more. But when I do a drawing for a fan, I want it to be good. I'm so happy to draw it the old way because this is what the fans want. When I get a note or email saying, Mr. Bellman, you made me happy with your work, it's framed. This means more to me than anything else. It's just a personal gratification that I get that I can make someone happy. It was just my art. They like my art. Some stories I love to do more than other stories. It's like an actor getting a script and they read the script and they say, not for me, and they give it to somebody else, becomes a big hit, you know, but the fact is, it's the same thing, but certain stories just would motivate me more than other scripts. Doing a comic book or doing any kind of comic strip is doing a movie. You have your long shot, your close-up, your bird's eye view, worm's eye view. You have to change each panel so you keep the interest of the reader. A lot is left to the imagination, and the writer was described saying, have him drinking or something to that effect, but use your own imagination. Like I said, it's like doing a movie, and you have to think as a movie with still pictures. There was one book already written about the comic book industry, but it came and went. But I had spoken to many writers. I said, why don't you write a book about the comic book industry? Everyone had a story to tell. You're living in the best country of the world. The opportunities are here. You cannot give up. You cannot surrender with rejection, because you will hit somewhere. Learn how to draw. Do not copy the comic book characters, because you'll never learn to draw. Learn how to draw anatomy, a woman's anatomy, a man's anatomy. So when you put the costume on a man, you will know where the muscles are. You'll know where the hands are. I always wanted to draw and tell a story in pictures. And my dream came true at the tender age of 18.
You can see more of Allen's story by visiting his website at allenbellman.com or meet Allen in person when he appears at Florida's SuperCon convention July 4th weekend. Visit floridasupercon.com for all the details.
Si nos dejan, nos vamos a vivir a mundo nuevo.
Our last story tonight takes us to the southernmost point in the Florida Keys, Key West, for the 18th annual Songwriters Festival. This festival features more than 100 songwriters performing over 5 days of sun, fun, music, and typical Key West hospitality. Let's take a look.
This is my 17th year at the Key West Songwriters Festival. My first year of ever coming here, it was me and Mac McAnally. I opened for Mac McAnally.
Somebody told me if I didn't play this song, I wasn't gonna be welcome in Key West no more. I wrote this down here about 18 years ago.
And we played Friday and Saturday night. Friday night, there were about 15 people in the audience, and then Saturday night, it was packed out. 250 people came to see us, and it's been going up, up, up every year.
It's really great to come down here and get to hang with a lot of amazing writers. I always feel like I'm in way over my head among all these writers here. These are the best writers in the world who come here for this festival. So they use me to fill in gaps between them. It's really inspiring to get to meet all these people and talk about what we do, you know, share camaraderie with people who do the same thing. And plus just enjoy the drinks that look like Disneyland and the warm weather, and it's lovely.
We started in the beginning just bringing a few writers down, and it's just been going, getting bigger every year, and more and more writers want to come down, so it's just growing crazy. We run about 150 to 160 writers a year, and anywhere from 40 to 50 shows in 5 days, so it's a lot of fun.
This, it's not a bad backstage area. People like to have a good time here. My buddy slash drummer Johnny Rattlash from the area, and he's like, man, it's going to be a good time. And, so I was up for that, and also, you know, there's a lot of great songwriters here, and I'm still developing and trying to be inspired, so I'm trying to get some of that songwriter mojo to rub off on me while I'm here. Just soak it all up.
Well, personally, I've always thought that the songwriter, the person who made it up, their version of it has something on it that the artists never quite get to.
It's a lot of the people that come down for the festival get to know the individual writers before and during, after the performances, and get to listen to the stories that go along with the song. So it is a real intimate situation.
It's about real. And if songwriters know anything, they know a little bit about real.
I feel like I have to bring it, you know, definitely. I will leave this place being an inspired songwriter, that's for sure. I never know what to expect. I hope it's going to be great, but from the response when we walked off stage, people didn't want it to be over, so that's always a good sign. People laughing and having a couple of adult beverages and having a good time, it's good.
There's just a vibe down here that that makes everything all right. That just makes everything all right.
I've managed to get through 25 years without a day job. I consider that success number one, and everything else is gravy.
I think since the Songwriters Festival started, it introduced a lot of new people to Key West, and it's just a great, I think it's just a great place for people to come down and relax, and I think that it adds to the creative juices when they're here, and it just they just tell all their other writer friends, and it's just become a big family down here. Well, honestly, Key West is not a hard sell, no matter what who you're pitching to, and with the writers, it's all been the same. They just all love coming down here, and it just keeps building bigger and bigger every year because Key West is just one of those special places.
As long as they'll keep asking me to come back, I'll be back down here for the Key West Songwriters Festival. Absolutely, it's too much fun.
This year's festival has come and gone, but you can find out more about the history and even look for more information about the next one by visiting KeyWestSongwritersFestival.com. That wraps it up for this week. Until next time, I'm Kalyn James, reminding you, stay creative. Thanks for watching. I'm Kalyn James, and from Locust Projects in Wynwood, this is Art Loft. Ready? Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from Locust Projects, this is Art Loft. Then it is good. No buzzer.
Okay. Excuse me. That's my cane. Sometimes I like to raise cane myself. Let's be nice to everyone. We cannot be everyone's friend, but let's try. There's so much going on right now. So please. Please. Cheers.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation. Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.